You might know this series involving pi, but the usual proof involves essentially reproving this series for arctangent, and then plugging in x equals 1. But this typically involves differentiation or integration. There are alternative proofs, which both Friedel and Brown and Mathologer have covered before, but those involve complicated number theoretic arguments. Is it possible to avoid both number theory and differentiation or integration at the same time? The answer is yes, and it starts with a clock, or rather, a clock with an infinite number of hands. I know that looks dizzying, but let's see what the infinite hands are about. We are going to label the hands by an integer n, which means this hand will complete n revolutions per hour. For example, this is hand 0. It completes 0 revolutions per hour, i.e., it doesn't move at all. What about hand number 1? As said before, it will complete 1 full revolution in an hour. For convenience afterwards, we will call this the minute hand, because the usual minute hand will also revolve around the clock in an hour. What about hand number negative 1? It is similar, completing 1 revolution in an hour, but goes anti-clockwise. So actually, hands 1 and negative 1 are mirror images of each other, which is a useful perspective later on. But for hand number 2, while it means that it completes 2 revolutions in an hour, I want you to think of it as going twice as fast as the minute hand, like here, rotating twice as fast as the yellow minute hand. And again, for hand number negative 2, it is just a mirror image of hand number 2, and we can keep going. When we add more hands together, it looks like this dizzying mess, but we can clean this up by just focusing on the tip of the hands. So altogether, it looks like this instead. But with this setup, what are we going to do? We want to focus on the average positions of the tips over a certain period of time, let's say from quarter past to quarter two. So the minute hand initially starts here on the right, and after this half hour period, it ends up on the left. But we want to know, on average, where is the tip? The tip has traveled at a constant speed, the lower half of the clock. Because of the symmetry, we expect the average position lies somewhere along the vertical line, but because the tip only travels the lower half of the clock, the average is also somewhere in the lower half, say around here. We will need to figure out exactly where this average position is, but for the time being, let's just say the distance to the center is d, which we are going to calculate later. What we have done is calculating the average position of hand 1 during the period of quarter past to quarter 2. But we can do the same for hand negative 1, and so on, for all the infinite hands on the clock. Then we add these up. But adding the averages should be the same as first adding the positions of the tips at each moment in time, then take the average. Now, whenever we add up an infinite number of things, we have to be very careful, especially the right side, if we want to be rigorous. More specifically, we will need to use something called Cesàro sums. However, for the time being, we will treat this more informally and intuitively first, and then use the framework of Cesàro summation to patch things up. So first, we compute the left side, and let's start with hand number 0, which is the easiest to compute the average position of. Hand 0 is stationary, it always points up. Let's just say the clock hand is 1 unit long, then the position of the tip is just 1 unit upwards. Okay, now on to hand 1 and negative 1. We have established that for hand 1, it is d units down from the center. What about hand negative 1? Well, it is just the mirror image of hand 1, so the average position is also its mirror image. In this case, the mirror image of the yellow dot is still that yellow dot, So altogether, these two hands contribute negative 2d units, or 2d units downwards from the center. Next, we go for hands 2 and negative 2. For this, just note that we are considering a half-hour period, which means that hand number 1 will go halfway around the clock, but because hand number 2 goes twice as fast as hand number 1, it just undergoes a full revolution within that half hour, and so the average position would be just the center of the clock. Of course, the same goes for hand negative 2. So altogether, the two hands contribute 0 to the sum. In fact, exactly the same logic goes for any even-numbered hands. During the half-hour period, the hand 2n will go n full revolutions around the clock. So by the same argument, all the even hands will contribute 0 to the sum. Now let's go to hands 3 and negative 3, where we will start to see a pattern. In this half-hour period, initially, where is hand 3? Well, the minute hand would be on the right, because from the hour, it traveled a quarter of the way around the clock at quarter past. So for hand number 3, traveling 3 times as fast, should go around 3 quarters of the clock to end up on the left. So in the half-hour period, hand 3 starts on the left. So during the half-hour period, starting on the left, it goes through 3 half-revolutions around the clock. But where should be the average position? Well, the first half-revolution has the average being d units upwards from the center. Then the second half-revolution contributes d units down from the center. And the final half-revolution contributes d units upwards. So altogether, we just take the average of these three and get d over 3 unit upwards. And by being the mirror image, hand negative 3 would also have this average position. So going back to our sum, we have the total for hand 3 and negative 3 to be 2d over 3 unit upwards. In fact, all the hands afterwards would fall into either of these two categories. In general, for any odd-numbered hands n, the hand goes through an odd number of half revolutions, and we just need to take care of whether the unpaired half is the lower half like here, or the upper half. This means the average position is going to be either plus or minus d over n, where the sign just depends on whether you got the upper half as the unpaired half or the lower half. Note that the first half revolution is always going to be the extra one, so the sign actually depends on where the hand starts. If you are like here, starting on the right, ending on the left, the sign is negative because you are traveling the lower half. If, however, you start on the left, ending on the right, the sign would be positive, so starting left means positive, and starting right means negative. Alright, so in general, for hand 4k plus 1, at quarter past, it should have gone 4k plus 1 quarters around the clock, which means k full revolutions and an extra quarter. So at quarter past, the hand is on the right, and so this hand will contribute negatively to the sum. As for hand 4k plus 3, similarly, at quarter past, it has gone through 4k plus 3 quarters of the clock, which means k full revolutions and 3 extra quarters, i.e., starting on the left side, and this means it contributes positively to the sum. Okay, so let's go back to the infinite sum we have. As said before, we can cancel the even-numbered hands, except for hand 0, so we ignore these, and then the contribution from hands 5 and negative 5 would be altogether negative 2d over 5, because this hand is of the form 4k plus 1, so we have a negative contribution, and we have both hand 5 and its mirror image, explaining the factor of 2 in front. Exactly the same logic shows the next term would be plus 2d over 7, and so on. So altogether, tidying a little bit, the sum looks like this, and there we go, we have the series. Now there are just two more things to do. What is d, and what does this whole thing equal to? Let's first tackle what d is. As a reminder, d is the average position of the lower half of the clock. At any point in time, the velocity of the tip is always perpendicular to the position vector of the tip. The position vector is 1 unit long, and for the minute hand, the velocity is 1 revolution per hour. But the circumference of the clock is 2 pi, and so we say it is 2 pi units per hour. And so, to obtain the position vector, we can just use the velocity vector. More precisely, we can rotate it anti-clockwise by a right angle, then divide the value by 2 pi to get the position vector. Because while the velocity is 2 pi, the position vector is only 1 unit long. But the same thing happens for the average position. We can do these to the average velocity vector to get the average position vector. And calculating the average velocity of the tip is not difficult. The tip has displayed 2 units to the left, doing so in half an hour, which means that the average velocity is 4 units per hour to the left. Next, we need to rotate this average velocity vector anti-clockwise by a right angle, then divide by 2 pi, which in this case is 4 divided by 2 pi units downwards, or in other words, the d that we are looking for is 2 over pi. So we plug this value of d back into our sum, in this case 2d is 4 over pi, and we finally have this complete sum. The really final thing is to see what this series equals. From the very beginning, we had this plan, and what we have done is that the left side can be represented by this series, and we now need to focus on the right side, i.e. summing the hands at each moment, then take the average. Let's say this is how the tips are distributed at a moment in time. It seems random, but it has some pattern in it. If the minute hand has traveled this far around the clock, say the angular displacement is theta, then hand number 2, traveling twice as fast, will travel exactly 1 more theta. And obviously the same goes for hand number 3. The same rotation could get us from hand 2 to hand 3. It might be also worth noting that if we start from hand negative 1, then applying the same rotation would also get us to hand 0. What this means is that this rotation sends hand negative 1 to hand 0, hand 0 to hand 1, and so on, kind of like the Hilbert Hotel. So each of these positions will still be filled after a rotation by theta. Like here, we almost have a complete match except for these two places, but if we have an infinite number of points, the before and after would be indistinguishable. So if the sum of the positions is like this white dot, because a rotation by theta gives exactly the same picture, the sum would need to still be at the original position. The only resolution to this discrepancy is if the sum was originally at the center, which wouldn't be changed by a rotation. So, because the sum would always be at the center, i.e. 0, in this half-hour period, the average necessarily has to be 0. So finally, we see that this series needs to equal to 0, which implies that this series has to be pi over 4. This proof, I think, is arguably the simplest because it doesn't require any knowledge of calculus or number theory. But we cheated a bit here, especially when it comes to the right side of the equation. This is only going to be a bit of a taster of how we can make this argument rigorous. Normally, when we sum a series, what we do is to sum the first term, the first two terms, first three terms, and so on. These numbers we obtained by summing the first few terms are called the partial sums of the series. In this case, we can plot the partial sums, and while the graph is oscillating, it oscillates less and less, and we would expect that it converges to a certain value, which in this case turns out to be pi over 4. This is what we mean when we write down the sum equals pi over 4. But this is not what we mean when we say the sum of the positions is 0. This is the partial sums graph, which doesn't converge to anything. And this phenomenon occurs at all times on the clock. Look, none of these partial sums graph actually converge. So why do we say the sum is 0? Well, if you are forced to make up a value to this series, what would you pick? It makes sense to pick 0 in this case, because it is like the middle ground of all these partial sums. This middle ground is called the Cesàro sum of the series. More precisely, we don't just consider the partial sums themselves, but rather, we take the average of the first few partial sums, and then see whether the averages themselves converge or not. If it does, it will converge to that middle ground. But in this series, because the partial sums already converge to pi over 4, this will also be the middle ground. So pi over 4 here acts as both the regular sum and the Cesàro sum of the series. But in summing the positions of the tips, if we actually take the average of the first few partial sums, we will instead get this graph, where we can see directly that the average does go to 0. This is what we really mean when we say that the sum is 0, the Cesàro sum is 0. So hopefully, this is a more complete justification of how this argument really works. And if this whets your appetite in infinite series, you might want to go to Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. In this course on integral calculus, they have a specific section on infinite series, covering the different tests for convergence, i.e., how do we tell the series actually has that regular sum? The good thing about Brilliant is the interactive elements, where you really have to do the maths to calculate the answer instead of passively watching videos. And if you are incorrect, they have detailed explanations for you. And it's not just this course. Brilliant has over 60 interactive courses for all knowledge and abilities, so you will find a course that you are interested in. What's on screen here is Brilliant's other course on dynamical systems. The interactive elements definitely are important in building intuition for this visual and also applicable subject. To sign up for Brilliant, head over to brilliant.org/mathmaniac to get started for free, and the first 200 viewers will get 20% off their annual membership. Go click the link in the description to sign up now. As usual, thank you for the patrons, and please subscribe with notifications on, like, comment, and share. It will greatly help the channel. See you next time!